All right, good to have everybody. I think I'm on here. We're looking in Romans, of course, and in Romans 12, verses 1 and 2, Paul calls them and he calls us to a transformed life. And then in verses 3 through 8 of chapter 12, he speaks of the need for humility and mutual service. And he says that we're not to have an inflated view of ourselves because we're all part of one body. And I just think that's a beautiful image. We're all part of one body, each functioning in a different but equally significant way. You see, different roles, but all in a significant way as we function together as one whole. And that's an important concept to hold. In chapter 12, verses 9 to 21, Paul gives some general ethical counsel. Focusing first, so that's 9 to 21, you get this general ethical counsel, but he focuses first in verses 9 through 16 on Christian relationships. And he says in that section that he speaks there of sincere love. Remember, love must be genuine, real, sincere. He speaks of this affection, and he speaks of brotherly love. He speaks of sharing with the saints in need, of pursuing hospitality, of rejoicing with those who rejoice, and weeping with those who weep, and of having an equal regard for one another. All of these things are just crucial aspects of community life. And Paul is reminding them of those things there. Then in chapter 12, verse 17 to 21, the focus there is on our relationship with the world. And that's where I want to pick back up. I'll read the section again, and then I'll repeat a little bit. That's just how I do, and then we'll go on. He says in 12, 17 to 21, "Repay no one evil for evil. Have regard for what are noble things in the sight of all people. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live in peace with all people. Do not avenge yourselves, beloved, but give opportunity for the wrath of God, for it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord. But if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him a drink. For by doing this, you will heap coals of fire on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." Now, I'd said a little bit about this section last week. But we're to repay no one evil for evil. And as I said, our culture's mantra is, no, that's not how we operate. If somebody messes with me, I'm going to mess back double. They hit me, you bring a knife, I'm bringing a gun. That's how it is. And so that's not how Christians are to be. We are not to repay evil for evil. And we're to exhibit to the world in the sight of all people our regard for noble things, our appreciation for and our commitment to things that are good, are right and holy. All of those things, we're to display that. And though the world is opposed to us, we're to do all we can to live at peace with the world. Yes, the world is hostile toward us, but as far as it's up to us, we're to live at peace with the world. We must not compromise what God has called us to be or called us to do, but neither can we gratuitously alienate the lost. You see, so there's this balancing act. I must be firm in what God has called me to be. I cannot compromise that. But I have to be careful that I don't just go about and needlessly alienate people and create barriers and fights and these kinds of things that aren't necessary. All right, so that's just part of wisdom and living. Now, when we're wronged, he says we're not to retaliate or seek revenge against the wrongdoer. And that's just the impulse, right? I mean, that's the impulse. When you're wronged, it's to retaliate. It's to seek revenge against the person who wronged you. But rather, as Christians, we're to allow God to deal with them. Now, that takes some serious faith. That's right. You're in God's hands. The God I serve knows everything, and I will trust him to take care of the wrong that has been done to me. We're to allow God to deal with him, and Paul's not talking here. This comes up sometimes. He's not talking here about using courts to resolve civil disputes between non-Christians. He's talking about personal revenge and punishment. As he's going to say, we're going to get to in chapter 13, governmental authority, the concept of authority within societies, is something that was established by God for the administration of justice. That's why God has done it. That's why he's created the institution of government within societies. It is to administer justice. It is to restrain anarchy and chaos. Okay, so he's created it for the administration of justice. So I don't see how it would be against his will for us to avail ourselves of the system he's put in place to administer justice. It's only lawsuits against brothers and sisters, you see, that are forbidden. And that's from 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And the reason it's forbidden is that those disputes are to be settled in-house. Now see, the church has become so fragmented and distant, they say, well, what is that? But if you understood that we were really a community of people, a community of believers, brothers and sisters, bound together by the Spirit, you can see how we would come, and if we have a disagreement about something, Joe and I have had some dealing, and we either misunderstand each other or something, and we think, wait a minute, that's not what we agreed to, and this kind of thing. Where would we go? We would go to brothers and sisters who would then help us in resolving that, rather than taking our dispute to people who do not share the Christian's worldview. That's what Paul's talking about. He says, how can you possibly, Christians, take your dispute before people who don't share your worldview? Can't you solve it? Okay, so there you see there's a distinction. He's talking about lawsuits of brothers against other brothers and sisters, you see, something. But in terms of availing ourselves of the courts to administer justice, Paul's not ruling that out. You know, Paul didn't hesitate to use the rights that he had under Roman law. You know, Paul was willing to use the rights given to him under Roman law. He used the fact that he'd been illegally beaten to insist that he and Silas be personally escorted out of the jail in Philippi. You remember that in Acts chapter 16, verses 35 to 39. Right, you know, so he sits here and says, well, are they going to beat me without a trial and this kind of thing, a Roman citizen? No, you have them come down here and let them take me out. Now, there are other things involved in that than just Paul's personal thing. Paul is dealing always with the gospel, you see. So there are other issues at work there, but he was willing to avail himself of Roman law. He also appealed to Caesar to hear his case, you know, rather than allow himself to be handed over to the Jews by Governor Festus in Acts 25. You remember, they're plotting this thing. You're just going to basically fork him over to a lynch mob. And Paul says, oh, yeah, I appeal to Caesar. All right, well, now the guy's caught. He says, well, okay, he's appealed to Caesar. He's availed himself of the legal rights that he has. I now cannot go with our little side agreement that I'll let you kill him on the way. Okay, so he was willing to do that. See, civil litigation, it's about compensation. It's not about punishment or revenge. But of course, it can be used with a spirit of revenge. You see, it can be used where you're just trying to go after somebody to ruin their life and mess with them because you're mad at them. Okay, well, that would then be a sinful spirit. All right, all that's kind of a footnote, just because that comes up sometimes. He says that we're to love our enemies and to seek their welfare. That's hard. Love our enemies by those who are hostile to us, those who are trying to harm us, those who are trying to do us wrong, trying to get us fired, they're enemies. And he says here that we are to love our enemies and we are to seek their welfare. We're to do that, he says, that we might lead them to be ashamed of their conduct toward us. That's this stuff about heaping coals on their head. You see, it's not so that, you know, we can destroy them, that they'll be killed or punished this way. It is hopefully that by my goodness toward them, they will be convicted of how they've been acting toward me, that they'll be convicted of how they're acting toward me, and perhaps repent and turn to the Lord whose love we embody. You see, that's the idea in this thing about coals on the head. there are a number of people who think that the origin of that metaphor as being referring to the pangs of shame, you see, referring to burning pangs of shame, a number of people think that may go back to an Egyptian practice, where you have some evidence for that they would carry a tray or a bowl of hot coals on their head as a sign of contrition. That would be a symbol of that. Others have other ideas of how this got to function as a metaphor for shame. So that's not the only idea out there, but I've run across this a couple of times where people think that that may be it. But that's the idea, you see, is that what are we to do? We're to bless them, to seek their good. And you're going like, how can you be doing that? I'm after you. I'm trying to hurt you. The natural response is for you to punch me back. Well, when you don't do that, and when you seek to bless somebody, really? You see, not trying to bless them in some, you know, fake way, but you're really seeking their welfare and seeking their good, trying to bless them despite how they're treating you. Hopefully, you see, that will pull them into conviction. And then the ultimate thing would be that they would turn and come to devote their lives to the Christ that we serve. Ah, okay, I think that's what Paul is getting after there. In chapter 13, verses 1 to 7, he says, "Let every person be subject to the higher authorities, for there is no authority except by God, and the existing ones have been established by God. So then, the one who opposes the authority has resisted the ordinance of God, and those having resisted will receive judgment on themselves. For the rulers are not a cause for fear to good work, but to evil. And do you want not to fear the authority? Do good, and you will have praise from him, for he is God's servant to you for good. But if you do evil, be afraid, for he does not wear the sword for nothing. For he is God's servant, an avenger for wrath against the one practicing evil. Therefore, it is necessary to be subject, not only on account of wrath, but also on account of conscience. For on account of this, you also pay tribute, for they are God's ministers when attending to this very thing. Pay to everyone the debts owed. To the one owed the tribute, pay the tribute. To the one owed the tax, pay the tax. To the one owed fear, pay fear. To the one owed respect, pay respect." Okay, part of the holy life that we are to present to God in this overlap of ages, in this time between Christ's inaugurating of the kingdom and his return to consummate the kingdom. Part of what we are to present to God in this period of this overlap of ages is our submission to governing authorities who have authority over us. And as Douglas Moo remarks, one can well imagine Christians who are reading the now too much in terms of the not yet. You see, this happens throughout history in terms of theological views, missing the balance between the already, the now, and the not yet. And so you could imagine Christians who are reading the now too much in terms of the not yet. You can see them arguing, the old age has passed away, and a new creation, we are a new creation in Christ, and we belong to the transcendent spiritual realm. Surely we who are even now reigning with Christ in his kingdom, we need pay no attention to secular authorities in this defunct age. Now you could see people say, what do we care about them? Christ is Lord. The Lord has come. I serve him. What do I care about kings and rulers and people like that? They're nothing to me. You could see that, right? Well, that would be misreading the now too much in terms of the not yet. And Paul says that Christians must submit to governmental authorities because those authorities have been established by God. See, to oppose them is to resist God's directive, his grant of authority to them, and those who do so will receive judgment. God says, I have created authority within societies. And so you are to submit to those authorities. God established certain institutions in this world. such as marriage, such as government, which institutions continue to have a positive role to play even after the inauguration of the new age, even after the inauguration of the kingdom with Christ's first coming. There are institutions that continue to have a role to play in the overlap of ages, including marriage and government. And so he's correcting this sense and this notion that, look, government means nothing. No, that's not right. Government continues to function until the consummation, when we have the new creation, the new heavens and the new earth, where we'll be together. And I've bragged on that scene many times because I love it. But so God sometimes, now we all often wonder, you know, about how this all works. One of the things to note is that our submission to governmental authority doesn't depend on their goodness. You see, that's a tough thing to, it doesn't depend on their goodness. It depends on the fact they're in a position of authority. Peter says the same thing here. Let me read you 1 Peter. I just didn't put that in my notes. But 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 13. Peter says, "Be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor as supreme or to governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you should put to silence the ignorance of foolish people. Live as people who are free, not using your freedom as a cover-up for evil, but living as servants of God. Honor everyone, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the emperor." You see, so it's not something that's dependent on the goodness of the emperor, because when Paul wrote this, Nero was the emperor. You see, now, Nero, his psychosis hadn't come to full flower yet. I got to say that. That's still a little ways down the road. But Nero was certainly an evil person, and yet Paul can write what he writes here. Now, we wonder about, God sometimes allows or he brings evil people to come to power. And he does that for various reasons, but it's just like the larger question of evil and suffering in the world. We often can't figure out what he's doing. Now, maybe you've already got all this wired and you can understand what God is doing in every instance of evil. I can't. I trust, though, his love and commitment to mankind, because once he had his son die, that ended that question for me. I said, I don't care how much I grope in darkness to understand what you're doing. One thing I know is that you're for me. You see? So, but I, you can't always chart through all of the things. I just trust that the God who loves me the way he does is working things out, and he is doing something for good in all of that. But in any event, God sometimes brings or he allows evil rulers, people to come to power, but he does it for various reasons. Sometimes we can see this or told this. Paul has already mentioned in chapter 9, verse 17, that God raised up wicked Pharaoh. See, here he's going to tell us, you see. He raised up wicked Pharaoh that he might be glorified through displaying his power against him. All right, so you say, well, why would he go? Okay, well, here we get at least an insight, an explanation of part of what God is doing in that. He says so that he could display his power against him. And as Jesus told Pilate in John chapter 19, verse 11, he would have no power over him if it weren't given to him from above. You know, don't you know that I've got your life in my hands, basically? Hey, you'd have no power over me. You'd have no authority over me if it weren't given to you from above. We see it a number of places in Daniel chapter 4, this idea that God gives the rulership to whom he will. You see, so God, now we wonder about this sometimes, but I say this is just a subset, a species of the larger question of evil and suffering in the world. But God does hold these evil rulers accountable for their wickedness. Daniel chapter 4. Daniel chapter 4 tells us that God caused the great king Nebuchadnezzar to lose his mind. Right? You know that story well. So he wound up living like a wild animal. And I can't talk about this without saying Richard Rogers' line when he says, somebody bangs on the door, "I've come to see the great king." Well, he's out grazing on the back 40. The great king's out there. But that's what happened. He was reduced to living like a wild animal. And it was not until he repented that his rulership was restored to him. And though God used the Assyrians to punish Israel, he used the Babylonians to punish Judah, he poured out his wrath on the wickedness of those nations. So you remember, that's what he does. So you see in Isaiah 10, Habakkuk. So he said, look, I'm God, I got it. So here's what we're doing, okay? How can you have these people over here? So, what's going to happen? No, I'm going to raise up them. How can you allow the wickedness? Aren't you holy and pure? How can you allow your people to live in such rebellion and wickedness? He says, okay, I'm raising up some people. They're going to take care of that. How can you raise them up? They're horrible. Don't worry about it. Okay? They're going to serve my purpose. And when they've done that, they'll be punished for their wickedness. Okay? So he uses these things and he has workings. Their ultimate punish, of course, will be in the final judgment. Okay, so we have questions about this God allowing rulers in these things. Now, it should go without saying, but I'm going to say it. It should go without saying that Christians cannot obey governmental authorities when to do so would mean disobeying God. Right? We can never do that. We cannot do that. As Peter and the other apostles put it to the Sanhedrin in Acts chapter 5, verse 29, we must obey God rather than men. Always. We must obey God rather than men. Otherwise, we would be placing government over God. You see, that's idolatry. We cannot give government our ultimate allegiance where God says, here is how you're to be, and government comes and says, no, I don't want you to be that way. You're to be this way. Obey me instead of God. Well, we can't. We cannot do that. You think of cases. I'm thinking about, China, where they'll say, listen, if you have more than, they claim they're going to change that policy. Don't know that that's coming about. But if you have more than one child, you're pregnant, you got to kill the child. Well, what do you do? No, I'm not killing the child. The government said to kill the child. I said, but God said not to. And so I'm not doing that. And you can think of other situations where this kind of thing would come up. Now, Paul doesn't mention that fact. You say, well, why doesn't Paul go into all that? He doesn't mention that issue here because his question was whether the saint should submit to the authority of government at all. You see, if this is the right reading, you're saying you have this idea of over-realized eschatology where somebody is saying, listen, I'm reading the now too much in terms of the not yet. I'm free of any government. What's a government to me? Well, Paul's just making the point, no, you are to submit to the government, so he's not going into this other issue. But there are notable examples in Scripture of this kind of civil disobedience, where the government says, or the ruling power says, you're to do this, and spiritual people say, no, I'm not going to do that. When Pharaoh ordered the Hebrew midwives to kill the newborn boys, they refused to obey. Exodus chapter 1, they said, no, we're not doing that. I know you, Pharaoh, I know you can kill me and all this kind of stuff, but I'm not going against God. I'm not killing these babies. I'm just not going to do it. When Nebuchadnezzar ordered all his subjects to fall down and worship the golden image, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, what'd they do? No, nope, not doing that. Well, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to throw you in this fire. No, all right. I don't want to go into fire, believe me. But I'm not going to do that. I can't do that. You see, that would be to disobey God and to put you above him. When King Darius decreed that for 30 days nobody should pray to any god or man except himself, what did Daniel do? No, I can't do that. You see, in Daniel chapter 6, when the Sanhedrin banned the apostles from preaching in the name of Jesus, the apostles refused to obey. Acts chapter 4, verse 18 and after. So that you see the idea that this is a clear biblical principle. And a statement, we must obey God rather than men. You and I cannot yield. Now, you get in some questions about, is this policy something that is causing me to go against God? All right, there's room for, things get hazy at times. I understand that. I'm talking principles. Do you see? The principles are clear. And so the clearer the situation, okay, then the principle applied. No, I can't do that. I cannot do that. And we have to understand that. Why? Because that honors God and shows clearly that God is supreme and not government. Now, the rulers, he says, they do not cause fear in those who submit to their authority. That's how I understand all of this talk of do good and good work. You see, I take it in the context of submit to their authority. Good work in that sense. The authority is established by God, and those who do good have nothing to fear. Those who submit to the authority, those who are loyal and not rebellious to the authority, well, they have nothing to fear. If they're good, loyal citizens who do what the ruling power wants, then okay, they have nothing to fear. All right? Not talking about always you would obey God rather than men. But when he sits here that they hold no fear for those who do good, he means for those who submit to their authority. If you wish not to fear the authority, then be a loyal citizen. Do good in that sense. And you'll be praised, for the authority is God's servant for your benefit. And the idea is that God has created authority within societies to benefit the people. You say, well, why is that? Because without that, it is anarchy. It is chaos. It is the strongest taking from the weakest. And so that would be a frightening situation for those of us who aren't really buff. You see, I mean, people just, you know, you just take whatever you want. Okay, well, authority, God placed it there to restrain anarchy, to restrain chaos, to be a blessing to mankind. So that's this idea. He's instituted the authority. That's what he means. It's God's servant for your benefit. Now, it's clear from this, or it should be, that there's no inherent conflict between government employment and Christian discipleship. This is another question that for some reason arises. Well, can a Christian be in the government? Can a Christian work? Yeah. A Christian can work in the government. God established governmental authority within human society. He did it to bless mankind by providing social order. So he provided the institution and the authority. So one who serves in the government is God's servant. Okay, to the extent that one fulfills one's role in the government consistently with Christian ethics. In other words, if you're in the government and you're browbeating people and stealing and all that, well then no. But that's not a function of your being in the government. That's a function of you violating Christian ethics. But a person who fulfills his role in the government consistent with Christian ethics, that person is acting as God's servant. Okay, so to that extent, the Christian works with God and not against him. And I just say that as another footnote, because as I say, this question sometimes comes up, people have issues about it. Romans chapter 16, verse 24 is an example. Okay, Erastus, one of the Christians, he's one of the Christians who sends greetings to the saints in Rome. He's identified as a financial officer. A financial officer within the local government of Corinth, which is a city from which Paul is writing. Likewise, in Philippians chapter 4, verse 22, he refers to those who belong to Caesar's household. They're among the Christians who send greetings to the saints in Philippi. All right, so those in Caesar's household, those were Christian members of the emperor's civil service staff. And Paul doesn't say, you got to get out of that. No. All right, so it's perfectly fine to serve and function in government as long as one does so consistently with Christian ethics. But if you rebel against the authority, he's not talking now about if you give God proper spot. If you rebel against authority, be afraid, because he has the power to punish. See, the governing authority is God's servant, an agent of wrath against the one who's practicing evil, meaning rebellion. You see, so he has power to punish if you rebel against his authority. And that's part of the enforcement mechanism that God has provided, the authority that he's created within the society. Now, this text is relevant, by the way, to the question of whether the death penalty, this text here where he says, because he has the sword. For he does not wear the sword for nothing. This is relevant in the question of whether the death penalty is immoral per se. Okay, not whether the death penalty can be moral per se and become immoral in its application. Right? If I only go and kill poor people, but somebody else who's got money, if I don't administer it fairly, well, then it can become wrong on that basis. But the question is it immoral per se? And this is relevant to that. Now, there's a debate over the exact background and significance of this phrase, wear the sword. But Craig Keener, in his Bible background commentaries, Keener's a New Testament scholar, he says, the sword refers to the standard method of execution in this period, beheading. In earlier times, the axe had been used. Swords were carried in front of Roman officials to indicate their authority over life and death. So it's relevant to this idea, is the death penalty instituted or administered by a governmental authority? Is it? And because you get people who say that. And they want to look at me as a Christian and say, well, how can you be a Christian and think the death penalty is okay? Well, I do think the death penalty is okay. I think it's not immoral per se. And I think sometimes it vindicates the value of human life if you take the life of the person who took a human life. You see, it's not noble to sit here and say, well, that's fine, that's life's okay, but it's not important enough to take your life. No. Okay, but as I say, there can come complexities in the administration of it. That's a different level of argument. Okay, whether it should be implemented under certain circumstances. Now, but even if this phrase, even if you take the idea of the sword, even if you think, well, it doesn't indicate directly the infliction of the death penalty, as Keener suggests that it does. Even if you say, no, well, it just more generally symbolizes the right of the government to punish those who violate its laws, I think moves on to something when he says, but in the context of first century Rome, and against the Old Testament background, Genesis chapter 9, verses 4 through 6, Paul would clearly include the death penalty in the state's panoply of punishments for wrongdoing. Okay, so I think that God has authorized governmental authorities to administer the death penalty. Okay, and so that's just an issue. I know there was a sister who was on a trial one time. And they'd ask her about her death penalty. She said, you know, I really didn't know what I thought about that. So at least you know what I think about it now. So you can chew on that, all right? So it's necessary. It's necessary to be subject to the authority, he says, not only because of potential punishment. Right? If you rebel against the authority, you understand that the authority is going to condemn you. Is going to punish you. But he says it's necessary to be subject to the authority not only because of potential punishment, but also because of conscience. Well, why? It's because the authority is from God. So when you rebel against that authority, you are rebelling against what God has given. And so that's going to offend your conscience, or it should. So not only because of the wrath and the consequences, he says, but also because of conscience. And he says, paying tribute. All right, paying tribute. Direct taxes. You see, that's even a matter of conscience, because authorities are God's ministers even when attending to tax collection. You see, he says, for on account of this, you also pay tribute, for they are God's ministers when attending to this very thing. Now, he may be talking more broadly. He may be saying, look, they're God's ministers when they're attending to tax collection, or maybe speaking more broadly that when attending to government service and function generally. But in any event, he says, look, the taxes are to be paid. We are to pay everyone, he says, the debts owed. Now, that's important. Everyone the debts owed. As a Christian, you are to pay your debts. You see, it's just for a Christian. Somebody who wears the name of Jesus Christ in this world to stiff people is not right. It's not right. When you owe somebody something, you pay it to them. I mean, I would think that doesn't need to be said. But again, I said it. You see, he says to pay to people everyone's debts owed. He says, whether direct taxes, whether indirect taxes, things like customs duties and fees, whether respect, whether honor, because governments, as I say, they restrain anarchy, chaos. They are instruments of social order, and they serve in that way the basic needs of the people, of the society. So we are to pay those things. So there's no justification for withholding the payment of taxes, okay, that they're going to be used for something I can't endorse. You see, that's their responsibility. That's their responsibility. I suspect that Rome used taxes for things that Paul couldn't endorse. But here he says, look, that we are to pay these things if you owe them. But of course, see, the part from our side, we are fortunate enough to live in a system of government that gives us a voice in selecting leaders and in influencing their policies. Not everybody has that. And certainly in the ancient world, people didn't have that. So we have an obligation, as I see it, as stewards of this political privilege that has been given to us, to exercise that for the good of people. I just don't understand Christians who say, listen, I have nothing to do with it. If I have lived in a society that has given me this stewardship of the privilege of electing leaders and influencing their policies, how do I get away with saying I'm not going to use the privilege that's been bestowed on me in a way that honors God? I'm not going to use it to try to create a just and better society, to try to help people, to protect the innocent, to protect those people who are vulnerable. How can I just sit and say I'm not going to care about that? Well, if I was in a society that I didn't have this privilege, that may be one thing, but I have it. And so I have a responsibility as a Christian to do good, not just to the household of faith, but to all people. And so it seems to me that I have a responsibility to exercise that privilege to do good. And now that factors into a lot of things. One of the things, in my judgment, that is clear as the nose on my face, and it's a sizable nose, is that the killing of children is something we ought to be working against. You see, the killing of babies, if we can't agree on that, then I think it's just crazy. But we ought to be concerned about that and use what power we have been given in a society. But that's for another time. Maybe. All right. Okay, 13. Here we go, 8 and 10. Owe nothing to anyone except the well-known to love one another. And it's interesting. He has the article there, and it just the infinitive. So it's like the to love one another. And so what you think he means is the, you know, just everybody knows this. So that's why I do it that way. Owe nothing to anyone except the well-known to love one another. For the one who loves the other has fulfilled the law. For the well-known, you shall not commit adultery. You shall not murder. You shall, all from the Mosaic Law, you recognize. You see, all from the Mosaic Law. He says, for the well-known, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet. And if there's any other commandment, it is summed up in this word, in the command, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does not work evil against a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Now, you know, now this idea, love is the fulfilling of the law, Paul plays off his comment in verse 7 where he said, every debt should be paid. And he says the only exception is the debt to love one another. Remember, say, pay to everybody what you owe. And he plays off of that and he says, owe nothing to anyone except this well-known to love one another. See, that's the one debt that we must never stop owing. That's the debt that we always owe. As a third century theologian, Origen put it, he said, let your only debt that is unpaid be that of love, a debt which you should always be attempting to discharge in full, but will never succeed in discharging. That is the ongoing debt. I'm always paying loving you. Well, this is Christianity, right? This is Christianity. Love is the heart of it, you see. If you love your neighbor, Paul says, you will not do your neighbor harm. That's what it means to love. We've turned love into this thing of, oh, I have this feeling. You know, I'm running through lilies, but it's got no meat on it. You see, it's got no strength to it. It is a sacrificial commitment to the welfare of another person. That's what love is. And so Paul says, listen, we are to love your neighbor and you won't harm your neighbor. That means that you will not commit adultery. Do you think it's loving to your neighbor to commit adultery with his wife? No. Okay, so if I love my neighbor, what comes with that? All of these commandments. You see, we want to take love and make it this amorphous thing, this thing without any shape that I can just move around any way I want and deny it any objective content. But it has objective content. For example, you will not commit adultery if you love your neighbor. You will not steal. You will not covet or do anything like that. Because all of those commandments are summed up in the command, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You see, the commands are simply specific ways in which love does no harm. They're just specific ways in which love does no harm. So love fulfills the law in that love does what the law demands. And you see, this is the idea that I tell you about. You see, you have all these commandments of the Mosaic law. That covenant is obsolete. And so those things that were peculiarly covenantal, the sacrifices and all of these things, the food laws that distinguished Israel from those things we don't do, but we still obey the do's and don'ts that are moral, you see, that come through just like Paul says. And I do it as a function of love. So love has content. So can I go to somebody and say today, you shall not commit adultery? And he says to me, that's Old Testament? That's how we talk sometimes. That's Old Testament? You can't tell me that? No, do you understand? You see how it works, and I've labored on that. I've said many times, the fundamental, the bullseye, the fundamental ethical requirement for the Christian is love. That's what Paul says here. He says it in Galatians chapter 5, verse 14. You can see it in Matthew 7, 12, Matthew 22, 37 to 40. This is the bullseye. This is the center. This is the essence of Christian ethics. But some specific conduct is loving and other specific conduct is not. There are these definite requirements on how love expresses itself. You see? And these definite requirements that came through that were within the law of Moses, they have continuing applicability and they find even their completion. Oh, that was the second bell? There you go. I'm glad so. Sorry about that. John's preaching tonight. Hold it. I remember. John's preaching tonight, and it's kick-starting the unbeliever's thought process.